This afternoon, we are very fortunate to have with us one of the first scholars who arrived at IRRI. Not the first scholar, but one of the first who arrived at IRRI. First, let me read his an introduction about him. Our guest speaker this afternoon graduated cum laude, BS in Agriculture, major in Agricultural Engineering at UPLB in 1959. He took his MS in Agricultural Engineering, major in Power and Machinery in UPLB in 1964. He finished his PhD in Agricultural Engineering in 1968 at the Iowa State University in Ames, Iowa, USA, major in Power and Machinery, minor in Mechanical Engineering and Statistics. He was an IRRI MS thesis research scholar from June 1, 1962 to June 1, 1964. He was a visiting scientist and an interim head of the IRRI's Agricultural Engineering Division from 1994 to 1996. He has written, presented, and published some 50 articles and reports on agricultural machinery and mechanization. He was a consultant of Agronomics Incorporated, UNDP, FAO, UNISCAP, and UNIDO. He's an expert in farm mechanization and transport for the Sisig, Gores, and Dalayo from 1974 to 1976. He also served as a professor of agricultural engineering and dean of UPLB from October 1, 1976 to December 31, 1983. He was also an agricultural machinery expert for UNISCAP from 1984, January to 1991, December. He has a host of other achievements, and I don't think we will spend the whole afternoon reading all of this. Well, anyway, we are very fortunate to have with us this afternoon one of the first scholars who arrived here at IRRI. So ladies and gentlemen, without much further ado, please join me in welcoming our guest speaker this afternoon, one of our first scholars here at IRRI, Dr. Reynaldo N. Lantin.
Thank you, Achu. I'm taken with this wonderful gadget here, which you are familiar with, I am not. It says here, it's a tablet, which has a use. If it senses that somebody is sleeping while I'm talking, it flies. Well, thank you also for that nice introduction. As an agriculture student at the UPLB, when I back 1950, late 50s, until I graduated in 1959, I witnessed the development of IRRI. So I am privileged to have that institutional memory, so to speak, from its founding, from its first spade work, because I'm from engineering, I was curious about what's going on. And you know this, where we are, and the whole of this little complex here around the pool was a hill about the height of the dormitory right there and the cafeteria. So this was leveled down and these buildings rose. But the first building that was set up was the service building, which housed the Department of Agricultural Engineering. And the whole experiment station was banana and coconut, essentially, with some rice paddies around. And so it was the ag engineer Lloyd Johnson, who was my mentor when I was here, that developed this experiment station. And I was sort of part of that as a scholar and sort of on the job training during its expansion. Oh, right there, more coconut plantations and so on. It had a wonderful setup of irrigation and drainage, never seen before in the Philippines. Road network, the same road network that we see now, except that there were no buildings right there in the rice paddies. This automatically goes off. So, The flurry of construction activities during the late 1950s, that was 58, 59, until the inauguration of 1960s, coincided with those of the McKeeling Forest, part of the McKeeling Forest, where the Jamboree site, you're familiar with that, is now located. So the Jamboree, World 10th World Jamboree, was first held in Asia in plus minus. So it was a Jamboree city. And you could imagine that that was a forest, sort of a virgin one, and that was cleared. So devastated, if you would say, that it could be seen, the activities there could be seen from the pharmacy building at Piri Drive, where we had classes. So with these two constructions going on simultaneously, if that happened today, there would, I'm sure, be some protests of destroying the environment because trees were really cleared up. But there were lessons. First of all, IRRI, the first international institute on crop research, developed into a world-class research institution, as we all know. While the Jamboree site was restored to the original forest, as you see now, in about 10 years only. And the lesson is, if you don't intrude on it, like the Sweden farming and so-called kaingin in Philippines, it will restore itself. Of course, there were interventions by the Boy Scouts who planted those trees. But this lesson is to lose our despair that we can never reforest our mountains again. I've always been in contact with IRRI also, aside from seeing the physical development, because we were just neighbors. Our building is the nearest building at UPLB with IRRI, practically neighbors. And we were very close in partnership with the Department of Agricultural Engineering. And they are, in other words, the IRRI staff was in fact appointed as affiliate faculty with the UP College of Agriculture, along with the visiting professors from Cornell University. So UP Los Baños was really strengthened by both IRRI, Cornell, and the scholars who have graduated from IRRI scholars, graduated everywhere through various fellowships. Now, why was Los Baños selected as the site of IRRI and the site of the World 10th World Jamboree? Because at that time, late 1950s, the Philippines was a burgeoning economy, only second to Japan, as they say. Second to Japan, but now no more. It's the last in the list. Now, what caused this leadership in the economy, second to Japan? I consider industrialization as the correct policy that made it. It was President Elpidio Quirino who, in 1948, he was president, had a policy of industrialization, and that's when these industries like the petrochemicals, the textiles, and all the others emerged, and this brought about more jobs and really a strong economy. But to my surprise, why are Philippine economic planners ignore industrialization in favor of agriculture? I'm not saying I'm against it, agriculture. When all the countries like, well, you can name it, our neighbors, from Taiwan, South Korea, Thailand, Malaysia, and now Vietnam, and Laos even, and Indonesia, they pursued industrialization to be prosperous, so that their they have more jobs and so on. They pursued it deliberately, but our old vision, the visions of our planners would be, oh, the Philippines is an agricultural country, and so we have to develop agriculture first. But they have been talking about this for the last 50 years or more, and nothing happened until we were overtaken by these countries who pursued it. Now I have a story, and I used Bangladesh as a model. Bangladesh, a country our critics sarcastically compare with, in order to make the Philippines look good, because we are second at least, not the poorest, but the second to the poorest. Bangladesh, according to one writer, is the most rice mechanized country in South Indian continent, subcontinent. Why so? Well, there's a story. In 1988 and 1990, it was ravaged by two successive cyclones. I think the magnitude like Sandy in New York, and many massive loss of lives and devastation of property, as well as the war animals, they were decimated. And so President Ershad at the time, had a problem. There was surely to be famine, because farmers could not work their fields. There were no work animals. So the recourse is to import, this is my field, farm machinery, from either of the two, Japan or China. Well, the engineers and the scholars said, we import from Japan because of high quality. It's for the good of the farmers. But there is another reason. But we need more machines with the limited budget. And so, but if we import from China, we have three or four times the number of machines, and we need those. So President Ershad abolished the committee and continued to import at the risk of his political career. He imported engines and tractors from China because, well, they are not durable, but surely they can last one season, which we need. And fortunately for him, there was rice production and there was no famine. And fortunately also, that decision ensued a kind of industrialization, a localized industrialization, because my machine, my machine, it was the seat of a foundry industry, indigenous foundry industry. And true enough, when the machines, engines failed, because the parts were easily worn out, they had to replace it. This foundry industries and machining works in Maimensee decided to make parts themselves. And they found out that they could make it better than China. So that was a thriving industry. It created more jobs, and Maimensee is a prosperous town in Bangladesh. Dr. Magor agrees with me. Because of that, nobody almost is jobless, because of that industry. So that is a lesson. With a happy outcome, and it is because of industrialization, little as it is. Now, perhaps IRRI too may consider undertaking activities, maybe probably as a advocacy at this time, in pursuit of the goal of, I quote the goal of IRRI, finding sustainable ways to improve the well-being of poor rice farmers and consumers, as well as the environment. Take note that there is the environment. The emerging culture is that if rural folks could help it, they would rather get away from agriculture and work off-farm to get more income. But the policy of making agriculture the sink of abundant labor, condemns the rural workers to poverty because they are poor employees of poor employers. So how can they be rich? Both of them will be at a loss, but are losing. So these workers must find a way to augment at least their income. And this is the model in Japan. The workers there, the farm workers, are aging. The average age is much higher than the Philippines. Our average age of farmers is 57, and at 57, you're not that strong anymore. So what do farmers do? They hire laborers. But unlike in Japan, the farmers there use machinery. They can work by themselves. Also, women have a greater role in farming. They cannot work by themselves. So in the Philippines, they hire unproductive manual labor. And that is the difference. So these salaries or wages of rural laborers must be augmented somewhere from off the farm. And that's why there's an exodus to Manila because the jobs are there. Unfortunately, this has caused urban blight. It has been my privilege to have been in the first, I was not in the first batch, second batch, or third batch, whatever it is. But the difference, April, May, June, that's the interval of the first, second, third batch. Where was I? It does not flash where I was. And I thank IRRI for this, for giving me the opportunities for doing graduate work. I hope that through the years I have not worked in vain vis-a-vis the noble objectives of IRRI in giving such scholarships for increasing the capacities not only for the Philippines but also the other rice producing countries. Now here's the story. After finishing my MS, or I was not finished yet at the time, in agricultural engineering, UPLB and UP Diliman. You see, at that time, the UPLB engineering here was not that developed. So I had to take courses in UP Diliman. And we were a pampered lot. My colleague who joined me later were fetched by car to Diliman and brought back here every Friday evening, every Friday afternoon or evening, because we had to attend the IRRI Saturday seminar and a course by engineer Lloyd Johnson. So before I was finished, there was a offer of Rockefeller Foundation Fellowship for PhD, and Dr. Chandler interviewed me on the eve of my birthday. And one of the most difficult questions he asked me was, how old was I? I said, 25. I was 25 then, because he had the biodata, short biodata. How would you lengthen your biodata when you are just a young man? Before him was my birthday. And I thought he was just testing me. And it was a catch 22 question. What is catch 22? Whatever your answer is wrong. I said, my answer was 25. And he said, you are still 24. Tomorrow is still your birthday. And in America, you reckon your age after your birthday. Quite true. I did not disagree. You're not supposed to disagree with an interviewer. I realized that it was a catch-22 question. I had in mind of reasoning that in engineering, 24.99 years is already 25. But if I answered 24, he would say the answer would be 25. So it is catch Catch 22. This keeps on escaping me. Okay, next. Really, my last word there is that this man, Chandler, was really smart. This reminds me of a story. A contest was held between a scientist and a technologist. They were given a goal, just like the air goal, of touching the lips of a sexy lady precisely 10.00 meters away. But precise, from the lips. The question was, give the minimum number of counts to have your lips touch the girl's lips according to the following rule. The first count is half of 10. That's 5. The second count is half of 5. 2.5. And the third count is 1.25. Right? Half of 2.5. And so on. Always halving the remaining half until you reach the lips. So what is the minimum count? And then you have to explain your answer. Well, the scientist answered very quickly. He was a mathematician of sort. Infinity, he said, since my lips will never touch a lips because there will always be a half remaining to be halved, no matter how infinitesimal it is. Quite right. We call that in mathematics an asymptotic to the line. Those of you who know this, it is quite approaching, but not quite touching. That's this asymptote. So that was a fine answer. Well, what was the answer of the technologist? He was practical. The scientist was theoretical. He said, I will settle for 15 counts. And that is after mentally computing, holding everything. He said, by that number of counts, my lips would be 0.3 millimeter, less than a millimeter, from her lips. And by phenomenon of thermal expansion, our lips would touch. So I'm practicing here. The practicality of the technologies and the preciseness of both are correct. But in real life, you have to be practical. And upstream members or the scholars and trainees and the fellows, when they get back to NARES or their institutions, will be solving real life problems based on science. I have just cited my experiences and observations as a research scholar at IRRI. I am sure that many of you have been either trainee, scholar, fellow at IRRI and had pleasant memories and rewarding experiences of stay at IRRI and Los Baños. Don't forget Los Baños. Perhaps as an IRRI alumni, we can join the UPLB in this so-called, what they call at UPLB, Los Baños spirit, a type of bond that is unique and felt more intensely, not in Los Baños or IRRI, but when you go out away from IRRI or Los Baños. That's what they call Los Baños spirit. And instead of saying IRRI, you can call it IRRI spirit, or Los Baños spirit, although we are not there. And it works in Philippines, at least. When one visits a place, they feel comfortable because of renewed acquaintances and bonding. And so since we always meet a staff who had been in the upstream, somewhere, in the partner institutions, you will feel at home with that spirit. Mr. Govinda, that's something to think about. And what have we to give here in return? I suppose that in recognition of the efforts, time, and resources that IRRI has spent on us a scholar, fellow, or training. It is but fitting and proper as a show of gratitude that we do our best in applying our knowledge gained to be productive researchers in discovering as scientists or innovating as technologists on various aspects of life in our home institution or NARES. Our countries that have sent us to IRRI would expect of us no less also. We owe also to the poor rice farmers, consumers, and to the environment, no less. When our best efforts have been made, when we have reached a breakthrough, when we, in adopting the idea of the famous English satirist, I think you have heard this, he is a famous English prose satirist, Jonathan Swift, who wrote in 1726, "It is of my opinion that whosoever could make two ears of corn or two blades of grass to grow upon a spot of ground where only one grew before would serve better mankind and do more essential service to his country than the whole race of politicians put together." Then we made a beginning. Just substitute two panicles of rice instead of two ears of corn or two blades of grass. With success, when we have improved the lives of our rice farmers, we would have repaid IRRI by helping it approaching its goal. It is the partner countries of IRRI, and in particular the NARES and institutions to which we may belong, that battleground spot in the war against poverty and plunder of the environment. Even at that, the approach to the goal is at best only asymptotic. Thank you.